So this modes of transfer is what are the different ways that memory and I/O, that is input output device, can transfer data by different means. What are the different means? Earlier we have seen that is something this one. This before handshaking, there is a stroke and it's a synchronous data transfer. So this is a synchronous data transfer. Here this is transfer has come, this terminology transfer in a synchronous data transfer. And here this is modes of transfer. So some curious guys may have some confusion. Are bhai, there also transfer has come, here also transfer has come. Then what is the difference then? So difference is this, carefully you try to understand this. What are the different ways that memory, that is your RAM, or any memory which is there inside the computer, your memory, that may be a RAM, that may be your hard disk contains memory, that is there inside your computer, memory, and your input-output device, I/O device. So how these two devices can transfer data between each, between them, among them. So this needs to be transferred here, or this needs to be transferred here. So how is that they carry out data transfer? That is what the modes of transfer, here we mean this transfer. You go here, this asynchronous data transfer, this again transfer has come here. This transfer is how devices know meaningful data, meaning this, here you are transmitting this data over the bus. So how is that the destination knows that this data is meaningful, valid? So that is in that perspective we are saying data transfer here. So a meaningful data being received by a destination unit or source unit is through this transfer. This is how devices know meaningful data really took place, transferring of meaningful data really took place between the devices. So that is this asynchronous data transfer. This transfer refers to this one, this meaningful data transfer. So we use this transfer again here in the modes of transfer. This is not about the meaningful data. This is how actually your memory is able to transfer data to the I/O device, or I/O device able to transfer data to the memory. So this point, if you understand, those who are really seriously studying, curiously focusing every word of the this subject, then they may avoid this confusion, this modes of transfer. So in this modes of transfer, one is programmed I/O method is there. The other is interrupt initiated I/O. The other is direct memory access. These are the three means, three methods, three approaches that we can transfer data between memory to I/O or I/O to memory. So let us see one by one, this three methods. Before that bit, again, orally what I have communicated, again, this point wise, let us see. Binary information received from an external device is usually stored in memory for later processing. This example I told earlier in earlier presentations, taking some text file, writing in that something, and store, saving it. So that is, I told at that point of time that this is being stored in my auxiliary memory, that is my hard disk, so that later on I can access it and I can process it. So information transferred from the central computer into an external device originates in the memory unit. So meaning of this is that file what I have stored, if I want to transfer that file to the external device, pen drive, so So this communication is actually taking place through this memory unit. Through this memory unit it is taking place. Information transfer from central computer, that is your CPU, to your external device. This external device may be your pen drive or your printer or whatever. But I just took an example, that file transferring last session, what I gave the example to the pen drive. So the CPU merely executes I/O instructions and may accept data temporarily, but the ultimate source or destination is the memory unit. CPU, in order to carry out this process, that is to transfer information from the computer to the external device, it has to execute your instructions. Once this instruction execution is done, the CPU is not going to play any role. So what is happening is, the communication is actually taking place between source and destination. The CPU is really not going to play any role. It is simply executing pure I/O instructions, that's all. So data transfer between the central computer and I/O devices may be handled in a variety of modes. Since the CPU is simply executing this I/O, and some other unit is actually handling this data transfer. This data transfer between the central computer, that is your CPU, and I/O devices may be handled in a variety of modes. Some modes use the CPU as an intermediate part. Among these modes we are talking about, to transfer this data, there are several ways here, variety of modes. These are the variety of modes. These variety of modes are here, this programmed I/O, interrupt initiated I/O, direct memory, and there is one more called IOP, that is input output processor. So these are the variety of modes. These variety of modes, in that variety of modes, this variety of modes, some modes use the CPU as intermediate for. Through the CPU they go all the time. Others transfer the data directly to and from the memory. So without the role of CPU, also transferring of data is taking place. So that is handled by these two, interrupt initiated or this direct memory access, without the role of the CPU. So data transfer to and from the peripherals may be handled in one of the three possible forms. So let us see each one. At any point of time, you please feel free to stop me. Guys, there. I think I'm audible to you people. At any point of time, you please stop me, unmute yourself, and ask the questions. So this is data transfer from I/O device to CPU. We have the CPU and we have the I/O device, and there is an interface. This we have seen already some sessions in the past. We have seen somewhere here this I/O device. Interface device. This interface is here. This interface. This is the processor. This is the interface. At this point, we talked a lot that there are several I/O devices. Each I/O device has got its own, interface unit. So this interface unit. At this point, we also talked about that this is having inside the circuit this interface unit. So the same thing is here again. In this modes of transfer. So this CPU, their processor earlier, the backslides, processor, and this is the I/O device. So the communication is through this interface. As said in my previous slides, previous sessions, that this interface also has got inside some circuitry. As part of the circuitry, few things are listed here. That is the data register and status register and the flagged single bit, flip flop, flag 1-bit register. So apart from this, you have some signals that are coming from the I/O device, requesting to the interface, saying that this data is valid, this I/O signal is conveying to this interface through this signal. When this signal comes, the hardware is so designed in the interface that when this data valid is high, then it assumes the hardware is so designed that when this is high, whatever the I/O bus contents are there, that needs to be taken into the data register. And also, it has to set this flag register, single bit register, and some status registers. About this single status register and flag register, long ago we have seen, in the past, that I/O communication, earlier slides, just a while ago, I referred them. So there we have been said that the status checking, like a paper is faded or not, ink is there or not. So such information is there in the status register. So, and then once this is ready, this interface unit is ready, having taken I/O input from the this I/O device wants to send something, and it has taken into the data register, it is keeping ready, because it has to synchronize also. The role of interface is many. We have seen it also has to synchronize the speed between I/O device and the CPU. CPU is working at higher speeds and it's working at lower speeds. So for that reason, it has to save the data, because directly it cannot transfer because they are operating at lower speeds. And then this CPU, what it does is it reads the status here and the flag register. If everything is fine, then it takes the data from this data register. It reads the data. So this one we will see here. This data transfer from I/O device to CPU. An example of data transfer from an I/O device to an interface into the CPU is shown in figure. This one we are talking about. This data transfer from I/O device to CPU. The device transfers bytes of data one at a time as they are available. So one at a time, byte. Byte means 8 bits. 8 bits being transferred one at a time. So the device transfers bytes of data one at a time as they are available. When byte of data is available, the device places it in the I/O bus and enables its data valid line. When this byte is ready with this input device, it enables this data valid. It puts the data contents into the I/O bus, and it enables this data value. So the interface accepts the byte into its data register and enables the data accepted line. Once this data been accepted by this interface module, then this interface enables this data accepted line. The interface accepts the byte into its data register and enables the data accepted line. The interface sets a bit in the status register that we will refer to as an F. That is flag. This is status we are setting here. So the interface sets a bit in the status register that we will refer to as an F. Or flag bit. The device can now disable the data valid line. This I/O device can disable this data valid line because it has been received by the interface. Interface has received the 8 bits. After receiving the 8 bits, as long as this data is valid, it is receiving that 8 bits and keeping in the data register. Having received the 8 bits, then it is setting the status register bit here. So having set this one, the device can now disable the data valid line, but it will not transfer another byte until the data accepted line is disabled by the interface. This is important. This is the important. But it will not transfer this. How long it is not going to transfer after disabling this one here? Data valid line is disabled when this data accepted line has enabled by the interface. This data accepted line is enabled when this flag bit is set. When this flag bit is set, when this is received by this interface, all 8 bits. Once all 8 bits been received by the interface module, this interface module is enabling setting the flag register, and also because of flag register being set, Then data acceptor line is enabled. Since data acceptor line is enabled, this data valid line is disabled. As long as this data acceptor line is enabled, this IO device is not going to send any new data to the interface module. The program is written for the computer to check the flag in the status register to determine if a byte has been placed in the data register by the IO device. Now, what is that this one doing? This CPU. CPU is actually going and checking in order to check this bit, whether bit is enabled or not. The CPU is executing a program. The program is written for the computer to check the flag in the status register to determine if a byte has been placed in the data register by the IO device. This is done by reading the status register into a CPU register and checking the value of the flag. So hope this is clear. Here it is executing a program. This program job is to check the status bit, status register, that is F, that is flag bit. If this is set, then it means this interface is ready with the data. If the flag is equal to 1, the CPU reads the data from the data register. The flag bit is then cleared to 0 by either the CPU or the interface, depending on how the interface circuits are designed. So here, if the flag is equal to, suppose as 0, and it is cleared if it is set to 1. That's why also we can design. This is a hardware design. So that's why it is said here, depending on how the interface circuits are designed. But in this example, if the flag is equal to 1, the CPU reads the data from the data register. Got it? The flag bit is then cleared. Once this is read by the CPU, this flag. So after that, the flag bit is cleared to 0. Either by CPU or by this interface module itself. Depends on how interface circuit is designed. Once the flag is cleared, the interface disables the data accepted line. Here, once the flag is cleared, this is being set to 1. When data valid has come, all the 8 bits been taken. When all 8 bits been read by the interface, this is set to 1, and CPU executes a program to see this is set or not. If it is set, then it reads the data from the data register, and then this flag is set to 0 again. This setting to 0 again is by either by CPU or by the interface. How actually these hardwares are designed. Depending on that, it may set to 0 or this program itself may set to 0 after reading data register. Once this is set to 0, then only this data accepted line is disabled. Till that time, so this data accepted is enabled high. As long as this data accepted line is enabled high, a new data this IO device is not going to put here or not going to send to the interface. Is that clear? Yes, someone can unmute yourself and talk to me, because long time if you keep this way, keep listening, and hardly you will grab anything. You keep interacting.
Sir, we need to transfer data from memory to IO, but we are dealing with CPU, sir, here.
We are, this example is data transfer from IO device to CPU. IO device to CPU means CPU memory. This data transfer is IO device to memory. So these address buses are there. These address buses are there to read this. This has got some address. This data will go into the CPU where it will sit. This data that had gone to the CPU, where it will sit. Inside the CPU, there is again memory blocks here, not shown. some memory blocks will be there. This data will go either to the memory block so that CPU can later on process it, or directly, if it is currently processing, this data directly can go to the processing elements such as arithmetic units, logical units. Like a CPU, the job of CPU is to compute. In case if there is no computation required, only if you want to read the file from the I/O device, this is suppose your pen drive. Suppose I/O device is a pen drive. Now you plugged in your pen drive to CPU. This plugging in is not going to happen directly like this. Plugging in is going to happen through interface. Now the user is operating the CPU. Since user operating the CPU, he or she will try to open the file. So during this opening the file action, there is a program back end, there is a program, USB program that is running. This program job is to execute few instructions so that these few instructions will go and they will check this flag bits. Meanwhile, this interface module is so designed to handle the USB any device. Yeah, in this case, our USB device is a pen drive. This is designed. This hardware is so designed, the moment you plug in this data, this will transfer the data, and if that data will sit in the data register, and it will, if it's not transferred, then at least if the moment you plug in, this flag is set to 1, saying that this device is ready. When user clicking here some file to access it, it means what, he or she is actually executing the instructions. Those instructions, in a no time, fraction of seconds, they go, they check this one, and this interface module acknowledges this to the pen drive I/O device, and this I/O device keep transferring data. Everything is going to happen here. So that way, this example is data transfer from I/O device to CPU. CPU, as I said, it will take this data to open. To open means it is not computing anything, it is just displaying for you. From where it will display, if that data is available inside the CPU memory. We mean CPU means to the memory unit here. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Are there any doubts? Others also can speak. See, I am going so slowly, rushing is again confuses. If you acknowledge your problems, then I can smoothly run. If you keep quiet, then there's no way that I can understand your problem. Kindly speak, because I cannot go to the chat window, because I have to come out of the presentation and then see the chat window. So instead, you please one after another unmute yourself and talk to me. Yes,
sir, everything is clear, sir.
Okay, that is one candidate. Thank you for responding. Are there any other who is finding difficulty to understand this concept, in understanding this concept? Are there any, please, those who are finding difficulty, I beg you please unmute yourself, help me so that I can clear the doubts. Are there any? I will count down 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, that's great.
Sir, that status register, can you explain once?
Yeah, definitely. I will explain. This is one doubt. Okay, let us see. Let us pick a few more doubts so that once for all we can pick and we can answer. Any other? One of our friend asking status register with explanation. Are there any others? So very 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 quickly, please help us so that we can save the time. I count down again: 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Okay, I think only one candidate having this doubt. No problem. I said many a times, I encourage, if you ask doubt, roof is not going to collapse underneath. Nothing is going to taken away. So remember these two. fundamental principles. If we are not asking, we are actually spoiling ourselves. We have to ask ourselves. That may be silliest doubt, no issue about that. So, no problem. Okay, let us very quickly come to this discussion again. There is no complexity, make the things very easy. Those easy things are like this, simple. That this, there is a CPU and there is an I/O device. Every I/O device actually will communicate to the CPU through interface only. So this is point number one. Point number two is, how is that this CPU is going to know that this I/O device has sent the data? That is the point number two. Because this CPU is operating at higher speeds and this I/O device is operating at lower speeds. There is mismatch. Suppose say if I am communicating, I am a CPU and you are I/O device. Blah blah blah, everything is meaningful to me because such a speed I am talking. But you as I/O device, you cannot able to grab what I am really meaning there. So for you, there should be some interface. What it does is, it takes my blah 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 and it does, understand, like that. Meanwhile, this blah 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 needs to be captured somewhere. That capturing is somewhere happening in the data register. Blah 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 blah, everything is captured in the data register. And this I/O device, this interface device, slowly understanding this speed and giving data to the CPU. So till that time, this I/O device is keeping calm because it cannot send any more data because already this data register is filled. How is that happening, that it is knowing that I shouldn't send the data? And how is that CPU understanding that data, meaningful data is available in the data register? This is through status register. This is happening through status register. Status register is a set of flip-flops here. Set of flip-flops. 1 minute, I'll go to this, our old friend paint. Our old friend paint now ready. So here I have some, I have to pick some. This is a status register I'm talking about. Like that. See, this is for, I'll write down, this is for ink. Printer, we are talking about the printer. For ink status is this flip-flop. And this flip-flop is for paper. Paper is there or not in the tray. That is. And this is for, is there anything to print actually? Is there? Anything to print. So like that, suppose we'll talk about this three, because we are just leaving them here. And now this is a complete, this entire thing is our printer, big box, a big hardware box printer. So here I have my that ink holder, cartridge or what you call, that thing, that holder. So this holder actually is connected with some sensors here, some sensors. This sensor is actually able to sense like the level of ink here. So say we say here this is top here, brim is this, top here is this. And down starts like this, ink level. So these sensors are actually trying, sensing here everywhere. The sensors are connected here. So what is the level to indicate? The electronic devices, these are sensors, you know, light sensors, speed sensors, like that. This is a some moisture sensor. Let us say this is a moisture kind of thing, ink means, or liquid kind of thing, wet kind of thing. So for that, there is a special sensor. Now this sensor value here, depending upon the level here, this is the one level, this is another level, this is another level, this is another level. Let us say this is the last level, there is no ink here. In this place, there is no ink at all. In this place, there is no ink. So sensor actually also connected here also. Here also sensor being connected. So if this is the every level is actually going through some, suppose say, OR gate, just for understanding this everything, and this is given to the flip-flop here. This is the one flip-flop, because after all, this is a status register. Status register means a group of flip-flops. So this is every one here is a, this is one flip-flop one, this is our flip-flop two, like that, a group of flip-flops are nothing but our status register. And everything here, this is given to OR gate, and this is also given to OR gate, this is also given to OR gate, this is also, something like that. So since here everywhere there is no ink, so let us say if no ink, then output is zero. It's giving zero. Since here also no ink, this wire also will give a zero output. Overall we are getting a zero here. So meaning this flip-flop is actually with a zero. Now you are having here your CPU. Your CPU is there here. This is your printer hardware. Now CPU is having some program, set of instructions here. While you, before print anything, before give any command to print here to the printer here, some programs are executed. This some 1, 2, 3 together are one program. Let us say statement 1, statement 2, statement 3, one program. Let us say. They check the status of the printer. So this printer, when program is executed, it will go first. It will check first ink is there or not. But very unfortunately, here it is set to zero. So what is that reply? It is going from the printer to the output. When you program, you execute a simple C program. If you write multiply, then what? If you execute that C program, it will prompt you enter two numbers so that I can multiply. So you are entering two. Enter, pressing your keyboard on keyboard. You are pressing enter. Then the other next line 3. So now you are pressing enter. So congratulations, your product is 6. Like that you can write a C program, no? So like that you wrote a program. The program job is to access this flip-flop and to see if this is set and give an output. Like that, the C output has come. Like that, to give an output. What is that output? This output is to sense this particular flip-flop only and to give a feedback that this is set to zero. If this is set to zero, there is another program executed. If it is set to zero and display on the monitor that there is no ink in the printer, like that. Is that clear now? Guys, you have to respond. What is the status register? Is that clear? Are somebody asked?
Yes, sir, it is clear. Yes, sir.
Yeah. What about others? Others? Can someone, hello, can someone speak? Is that clear?
Clear, sir.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. So let us back to our discussion here. This one, we are here. This one, I'm just picking my pointer. So this status register is working like that, the way just in a paint friend I demonstrated. Some programs are coming here, these IO read programs, they come here, they check this status register, if it is set. For example, in this status register, there are many actually, not only this flag. We are actually, in this example, we are simply discussing about the flag only. But in a reality, this status register will have several. The way in a paint friend, just now I said, one is for ink, one is for paper, one is for the tray. I mean, that top of the printer is closed or not. So several such status registers, this is having several flip-flops. Among these several flip-flops, there is a one flip-flop we are talking about in this example, so that we can understand what is how the data transfer is happening. Programmed I/O, this is called programmed I/O transfer. So this is how it is happening, that it senses this flag. If the flag is one, CPU reads the data, CPU got the information that yes, it is ready now. The meaningful data is available in the data register. When CPU is knowing, your data flag, this flag is set to 1. So then CPU reads that data from the data register. So once the flag is clear, the interface disables the data accepted line, and the device can then transfer the next byte data. So that is what happening in this so far. This we continued our this one data transfer from IO device to CPU. How really happening? That one we focused so far. How really happening? So now this data transfer may happen from CPU to IO also. But in this example, we took IO to CPU, IO to CPU. Likewise, CPU to IO also may happen. But this is happening how? Meaning one way is to make it possible through programmed IO. So these are the three methods I was telling you. What are the different ways that memory and IO can transfer data? So somebody asked, you're talking about the CPU, but where is the memory? So for that also, I gave given the clarification that saying the CPU, though CPU are telling where that data will sit, data should sit somewhere. Somewhere means that somewhere nothing but memory. Though we have shown CPU, why we have shown CPU? CPU executes two instructions. That is, execution of two instructions is essential. For that reason, we have shown here, because here somewhere we said CPU merely executes the IO instructions and may accept data temporarily, but ultimate source and destination is the memory unit. This is the main point. The guy who asked the where is the memory should focus this point. I took up actually this point before going to this point has come even before we had gone to here. So this one, so CPU, it comes into the picture just because of the reason is that it has to execute the instruction, but ultimately that the data will go into the memory, or it will go from the memory to the IO. So that way. But it also can come to the temporarily, as I said, instantly this data may go to the memory, or it may come to the computation. If instantly, if it is computing, multiplying, then data may not go to the memory. It may come to the CPU directly for computational element. So anyway, hope the one who earlier asked, he got the point. If not, then most welcome. Anytime you can ask if this is not clear. Let us come to this one, to the other guys, status register. Status register is not only having this flag, it is having several other flip-flops, but we are taking only this for understanding purpose example. So that should be clear. So now coming to this one, all this is about from here to this slide one, this that is 47 slide, and this 48 and this 49. All three are speaking how actually data transfer is taking place between IO to CPU. This is under modes of transfer. Tomorrow in external exam, if it is coming, write a brief notes on modes of transfer. So you have to write slide this contains slide number one. This is, let us say, one, this two, three, four, and this four. That's it. These four slides contains fewer points are there. Slide wise, you four. But if point wise, if you see in a half page, you can accommodate all these points. So hope this is very clear. Examination point of view, I'm telling you once again, this is important. It will come right about modes of transfer. So in that case, for five marks it will come. This theory will come for 5 marks. This theory. Okay. Now, this is another part of the question, that what are the methods, what are the various methods to transfer, what are the various modes of transfer. So in that case, about this you have to elaborate: programmed IO, interrupt initiated IO, and then direct memory access. That is as another question of the same topic. So again, this is for 7 marks. This theory is for 5 marks. This is for 7 marks. So now, coming to the 7 marks. Here are the 7 marks. So Programmed I/O operations are the result of I/O instructions written in the computer program. So, programmed I/O operations are the result of I/O instructions. Just now we said here, the CPU merely executes. CPU merely executes I/O instructions. So, if CPU is executing I/O instruction, that is the programmed I/O we can call. That is a programmed I/O. So programmed I/O operations are the result of I/O instructions written in the computer program. Each data item transfer is initiated by an instruction in the program. This data item, you should not be forgetting, this data item is there in here, this data item is transferred. Each data item is transferred. How it is transferred, each data item? This is how it is transferred. Is initiated by an instruction in the program. For every byte, this I/O instruction needs to be executed. Why? Because we had to ensure that byte has come and sitting in this data register. For every byte, this CPU has to execute instruction so that this flag can be tested that this is set to 1. Then only this data register contents can be taken by the CPU. For that reason, for every byte transfer, this has to execute an instruction. So that is what this meaning is. Any doubts about this 2 points? Any doubts? Are there any doubts? Guys, please respond. Okay, no doubts, I guess. So the transfer is to and from a CPU register and peripheral. This is again very obvious. It may be from CPU to peripheral, peripheral to CPU. Other instructions are needed to transfer data to and from CPU. This is important. This part is important. Other instructions are needed to transfer data to and from CPU and memory. These instructions are needed to check the flag status register, whether the flag is set to 1 or not. Other than these instructions, some other instructions are also required so that this data transfer can be done from that I/O, that interface module to the CPU, or CPU to the I/O devices through that interface module. So other instructions are needed to transfer the data to and from CPU and memory. Transferring data under program control requires constant monitoring of the peripheral by the CPU. So this is again the same. Once a data transfer is initiated, the CPU is required to monitor the interface to see when a transfer can again be made. It is very obvious. So as long as this data transfer is taking place here, this all the time it should go there and check this one, and if it is set to 1, then transfer this one. So likewise, this will go on. How long this will go on in subsequent slides, we'll see now, shortly. So that is, once data transfer is initiated, the CPU is required to monitor the interface to see when the transfer can again be made. It is up to the programmed instructions executed in the CPU to keep close tabs on everything that is taking place in the interface unit and I/O device. So who is taking care actually? This programmed instruction. Who is writing this programmed instructions? You as a programmer to ensure that how long this CPU should check those flags. It is cannot keep checking that for a while. Suppose say for 1 minute this checking flag is set or not. So more than 1 minute you don't want to check. So 1 minute you keep checking that flag. So after 1 minute the time elapsed, then it will do some other job. Again, after a while, again it comes and again it checks whether flag is set to 1. Because if there is any peripheral being set. So that is the headache with this programmed I/O. You'll see shortly, this is inefficient. You see here, inefficient. This way of accessing I/O devices contents to the memory and giving memory contents to the I/O devices is inefficient. This mode is called programmed I/O mode. This programmed I/O mode is inefficient. Why? Very, very, very quickly we'll wrap that session also. See. So now the programmed I/O method is particularly useful in small low speed computers or in systems that are dedicated to monitor a device continuously. this is very obvious. The difference in information transfer rate between CPU and I/O device make this type of transfer is inefficient. Why this is inefficient is the answer here. Consider a typical computer that can execute two instructions that read the status register and check the flag in 1 microsecond. So I was talking about all that, so far discussion. This will check here. So to check this one, it is taking 1 microsecond. For example, let us say that it's taking 1 microsecond to check that status register. I assume that the input device transfers its data at an average rate of 100 bytes per second. 100 bytes per second. This is equivalent to 1 byte every 10,000 microseconds. This one should be clear. Someone can take pen and paper, can ensure that this is correct. This is what? 100 bytes per second. If you are transmitting 100 bytes per second, then 1 byte, to transmit 1 byte, what is the time taken? Means 10,000 microseconds. Is that clear? This point, is that clear to everyone there present?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Others, anyone having problem, they can unmute and can ask. How it is that you explain, I am not understanding. Like that, you please unmute and ask. I think it is clear to everyone. That's why no one is, I assume this way. If no one is raising a doubt, I will assume that it is clear to everyone. Because I am repeatedly asking, if you have doubts, you unmute yourself and talk to me. I cannot skip this presentation, go to the chat window and see. Rather, you unmute yourself and talk to me. So since no one talking, I assume that it is clear to everyone. So now let us proceed to other one. This means that CPU will check the flag is 10,000 times between each transfer. So I complete this one by saying that what is required to check the flag? It has to execute two instructions, okay? So the time taken is 1 microsecond just to check the flag, whether flag is set or not. Once this flag is set to 1, it transfers that data register having 8 bits, nothing but 1 byte. This 1 byte to transfer, the time taken is 10,000 microseconds. Meaning this CPU, after this 10,000 seconds, again it has to come and check the flag. Meaning 10,000 times time units. This in parentheses I kept, the time units may be nanoseconds, microseconds or seconds. That's why 10,000 times between each transfer, for every transfer, 10,000 times this flag checking needs to be done. Is that clear? Is that clear to guys? You please respond.
Yes, sir, it's clear.
Oh, yeah, okay, thank you. So the CPU, what it is doing then? It is simply wasting time while checking the flag instead of doing some other useful processing task. That is the conclusion. This programmed I/O is utter flop. That's why we say it is inefficient. Why it is inefficient? Why it is utter flop? This is the reason. The utter flop reason is this, that to check the flag, it has to execute two instructions. This execution of two instructions itself is actually taking 1 microsecond. And to transfer 1 byte, it is actually taking 10,000 microseconds of time. Meaning, to go and check again the flag, whether another byte is ready or not, this 10,000 times it has to wait, this time units it has to wait. And then that flag, it can check. Otherwise, it cannot check, because this much time is anyway it is taking just to transfer 1 byte from that interface data register to the CPU memory. Till that time, it has to wait. So that's why the CPU is wasting that time while checking the flag instead of doing some other useful processing tasks. That's why this is inefficient. Remember, this is important examination point of view. That's why we go for interrupt enabled. So I am not going to take up this for discussion. I wrap by just in 30 seconds introducing, 30 seconds only, not 1 minute, 30 seconds. That 30 seconds is, instead CPU checking all the time that flag is ready or not, I/O device will come and knock the door of the CPU. Oh, Baba, I am ready now. till that time CPU will be keep doing some other job. That is 30 seconds over. So how that IO device is coming and knocking the CPU door, oh Baba, I am ready. And CPU meanwhile doing its own happiest job. So let us see in next session, hopefully. So if you have any queries, I encourage you, you stay here and you ask. Otherwise, you can leave because already people are 28. At the time, 29 messages, 36 people. But at the time when I started, people were some 45. So it means what people, they left the meeting.